Welcome to episode 28 of the Matt Levine My Generation podcast. This week we have a very special guest. He is a 2018 ACC Freshman of the Year, 2018 Phil Mickelson Freshman All-American, 2018 Ping Third Team All-American, 2019 two-time ACC Golfer of the Month, 2019 First Team All-American, 2020 ACC Golfer of the Month, owns 7 collegiate wins, low American at the 2020 U.S. Open, 2020-2021 Haskins Award watch list. John Pak, a senior golfer at Florida State, my neighbor, Scotch Plains native. John, how are you doing?
I'm doing great. How are you guys been?
I'm doing well. You've been good. No, that was a terrific intro you put together right there.
Yeah, we had to. There's so many more accolades. We couldn't fit them all in the intro. I did my best to pick out the ones that were most impressive.
Yeah.
So John, you're finishing up your senior year at Florida State now. How is school going for you, especially with COVID and all? Like, what's changed?
It's been great. Obviously, with COVID, so much has changed. You know, we're not allowed into certain facilities. I guess you just have to be socially distant all the time. And, like, there's always people watching, so you have to be very careful. And, you know, just they're not taking it as a joke out here in school. So everyone's being very careful. We're getting tested every week, and it's so different. And I'm just glad we're having a season because, you know, I know certain schools, like some of the Ivies, canceled their season, and, you know, it just really sucks to not be able to compete in your sport. So I'm just very fortunate to be playing this year.
And how has this kind of like affected your training? Like I was researching earlier, and you like to practice 6 to 7 hours per day. Like has COVID gotten in the way of that?
I don't think so, because I guess the one thing that has been a little annoying, I guess, is we usually work out at the stadium, and it's a nice gym, like all so many different weights and stuff. But now we have to do like a little different workout at our, you know, little team building at the golf course, and it doesn't have like heavy weights and stuff. So that's one thing that's been, you know, kind of hard because of COVID. But I honestly think I've still been getting the same amount of work before COVID.
Gotcha.
Are there any new rules or restrictions this year with COVID and college golf?
Yeah, so we have a team building, and our lockers are in there, and we can't use those. So usually after practice, we would all like head up there in the lockers, you know, put our stuff away and sit down and talk for about 20 minutes and try to figure out a place to eat. So we don't really get to do that anymore. And from a golfing standpoint, I think during tournaments, we had to play within our own team at our first event, which is kind of a different format. So we would play in 5 sums with our own team. Or no, we played 3 sums with our own teammates. Usually you're paired with players from a different team. But because of COVID, you know, the first tournament, they wanted everyone to stay together and, you know, travel together and, like, not come in contact with someone from, like, you know, Clemson or UVA. So that was a little different. So, yeah.
So is it like when you arrive at the course on match day, pretty much, like, what is like the feeling? Like, how is it like much different from like before? Like, is your mindset different because of like the extra restrictions?
I would say personally, no, but it is different because, you know, I've got a good amount of friends on different teams, and, you know, you haven't seen them in a while. You want to dive them up, give them a hug, or, you know, it's just you can't do that anymore because you never know. Well, you know, they may have stopped by a gas station and, you know, you could get it there. So that's I think that's the main difference. You can't be as friendly and close with people that, you know, I've known for a long time.
And are you forced to wear masks while you're playing, or are there no masks, just staying apart from each other pretty much?
Yeah, since we're outside and it's probably the most non-contact sport you can think of, we don't really have to wear masks. But, you know, whenever we're indoors in the clubhouse, you know, then we do have to wear masks.
And so before we kind of transition into like your growing up in Scotch Plains and then moving to Florida, I just have one final question. So you currently hold the you're second in collegiate wins for FSU. Do you think, are you planning to break that record this spring?
I you know, that's, I have like a calendar right next to me on my desk, and I put all my goals on there, and that for sure is definitely one of my goals. But obviously our main goal is to win the national championship this year as a team, and we got a pretty good team, so I'm looking forward to it.
Awesome.
So transitioning a little bit to your early life, Scotch Plains growing up, obviously we're all Scotch Plains natives. Who introduced you to golf originally?
So, no, you probably know this, but my whole family plays golf. I've got three older brothers. So my oldest brother is now 31. So he's 9 years older than me. And when he was 15, he started playing, and I just kind of tagged along with him. And, you know, he was actually a pretty good golfer. He won counties, I think, his junior year in high school. So he was a decent golfer. He was pretty solid. And I just picked it up with him. And then that's kind of how it all started for me.
How many times did you lose to him before, like, you finally just, like, demolished him?
Honestly, that's a great question, because I have three older brothers. So obviously when we first started, I was always getting beaten. But I want to say it's right around when I was 12 or 13 where, you know, it was tough for them to beat me. I think that was right when it kind of started to get pretty good. Yeah.
You spent 1 year at a Scotch Plains Fanwood High School. Like, what do you remember from that year? Just looking back.
I remember I had some awesome teammates, Jeremy Haas, Tyler Danker, and Connor Schmidt. We had a fun time, and I think the highlight was we beat like the number two ranked team in New Jersey. I think it was St. Peter's Prep in like a little 9-hole match, and everyone was getting fired up. So I always remember that.
So when you were coming into high school, did people already know about like your game, like prior to like you being a freshman?
I think they did, because I had three older brothers. They all played high school golf. I think all three of them were the captain at one point. So, you know, they from the generations, and, you know, yeah. My brother David was 5 years older than me. So he played with Jeremy, Connor, and Tyler. So then once I got there, I knew them as well. And they're like, "Oh, it's John." I was like, "It's just me, man. I'm just trying to play some golf. That's all."
But then, like, so you had three older brothers. They're not as good as you. So, like, they're expecting a good golfer, but were they expecting the type of golfer that you are and now you are today?
I think people did believe in me a lot, which I thought was awesome. And people don't realize, like, how tough it is to make it as a golfer. It's so hard. And, you know, I think just like a 0.001% chance when you're born to, you know, make it onto the PGA Tour. So, you know, people always believed in me, and I know all my teammates did back then in high school. So, they believed in me.
That's awesome.
Was there ever a point or like a moment when you decided like, this is what I want to pursue?
I think, probably when I was about 12 years old, I played in like the US Kids World Championship, and, when I was 13, I played in the Teen World Championship, and I finished second. And, you know, I always remember this. I bogeyed my last hole, lost by one, missed like a 6-footer. And it was a big learning experience for me, but I knew, like, you know, that was kind of like top of the top, the U.S. Kids World Championship, kids coming from, you know, different countries, and not just different states, but different countries and all over the world. So, you know, to finish second there, I was like, guess I might be pretty good. Might as well give it a try. So I think that's when it kind of started for me.
And so then after your freshman year, you move to Florida and you move in with your uncle who homeschools you and takes care of you. What kind of like went into that decision?
So, yeah, you know, obviously my parents and I talked about this a lot, and I originally didn't want to do it, but I don't think I'd be where I am if I didn't do that. Cause like you said, you guys just got 2 feet of snow the other day. Yeah. It's 75 degrees and a little rain today, but 75 degrees, and when you're able to practice all year round, it's just such a big advantage. And I think, you know, my dad, I didn't understand at that time, but I do now. And, you know, like I said, I wouldn't be here right now if it weren't for that decision.
And do you remember like the day that like your parents sat you down and like pitched this idea to you?
Not really. I just remember like arguing with them and just, you know, like, I don't want to do this, but it was definitely a big sacrifice I needed to make. And, you know, I think most of the top athletes can relate to this. If you want to be the best, you got to sacrifice a few things.
So how are you able now down in Orlando to balance your school and your golf life? Like how did that change once you were down there?
I had a very hard work ethic. So I'd take Mondays off, but 6 days a week, I would, you know, just golf in the morning and then schoolwork. And that's it. My whole life was just golf and schoolwork. And, you know, my dad was definitely a big influence on that. But, you know, like I said, if you want to be the best, you got to put in the work. And, you know, that's kind of what pushed me to, you know, do all the things I did. So,
did you explore Orlando or go to Disney World or was it?
Yeah, of course. I had a friend, his name is Alex Lee, played golf, and, you know, he was my best friend in high school. So we'd always on Mondays do something because the golf course was closed on Mondays. So that was my one day off. So we'd do something.
Gotcha. Very cool. So let me look at my questions here. So was there a moment like when you were in Florida, at least like during like the first year of this transition where like after a long practice or like a rough day on the course, you're like, I just want to be done with this. Like, I just want to go back home.
Definitely, for sure. I mean, do you guys play golf at all or not really?
Well, I've gotten into it a little. I've tried to get our friend group into it. Matt's starting out. Not the most coordinated golfer, but
yeah, it's a very rough life for me as a golfer.
Golf is so stressful. So like, you know, I'll always have those days, and you know, you just gotta push through it. So I definitely had those days where I just, you know, I had a bad day, you know, don't want to play golf anymore. But at the end of it, you look back on it and it's really just golf. So, you know, I just kind of just push myself through it and, you know, just next day will be better. So yeah. I know it's a tough game. So you just gotta learn that it's really freaking hard.
You got a chance to fly home for the holidays. And so I saw you every so often. When you got to fly back home and see your family again, what was that like? Like, was it an experience that made you want to come back? Or was it like, I'm here to spend a couple days with you and then I'm ready to get back to work? Like, what was that like?
I love my family a lot. So every time I come back to New Jersey, it's always good to see them and spend time with them. And it's kind of weird as you get older, you know, I used to live with them when I was younger, so I knew everything they were up to. And, you know, I hear different stories and like, it's just always nice to catch up with them. Like one of my brothers, he just bought a house the other day. So you hear all these different things and it's exciting, but it is what it is. I can't like take more than 3 or 4 days off. So, you know, I get to see them and make the most of my time and, you know, spend time with them and, you know, we have a good time, but you know, do that and get right back to it, go back to Florida and right back to work.
Do you have any other, are all your siblings and most of your family located in New Jersey? Or are they also around like different parts of the country?
Everyone's in New Jersey except me.
So do they ever, so I know you fly home for the holidays. Do they ever fly out to see you?
No, they don't. Well, I think soon once I get my own place in, you know, Florida, so I live in a college town, so I don't know if they really want to visit me here.
Yeah. Do you have any like plans for where you're going to move in Florida? Are you going to go back to Orlando?
I think I'm going to move to Jupiter, like West Palm area. It's there's a couple of really nice golf courses in that area.
Got it.
Sort of going back to the hard work, I get to talk to your dad a lot about he loves talking.
He does love to talk.
Yeah. He talks all the time about how much of an impact hard work has in success. So like, how much of an impact has that sort of mindset had on your golf career, and what sort of values has he instilled in you?
I think that's a great question, because I still agree with that. And, you know, I guess one person I've had the chance to talk to and meet was Tiger Woods, and he's my favorite golfer of all time. And, you know, you just hear all these stories of all the countless hours of practice he put in the game, and look where he's at now. He's the greatest golfer of all time. So
yeah.
I truly believe that if you work hard, you'll get there. And, you know, seeing, I don't know, we got 13 guys on our team right now, and then I've had, you know, at least 10 guys go onto the team and leave while I've been here. And you can just see the guys that work hard are always, you know, playing the best. And, you know, I truly do believe in that. And I think with hard work, you also gain confidence, and confidence in the game of golf is so important. And I believe that with all that hard work, I gain confidence, and with all that confidence, that's what helps me play well.
And kind of transitioning into that conversation with Tiger Woods that you had. So that was after you were the only amateur golfer to make that US Open cut. So like, what was that like? And then to have like the likes of Tiger Woods, who you just said your favorite golfer of all time, come up to you and give you some advice. Like, what was that like?
So yeah, I was, I think that was Thursday or Tuesday before the tournament. I saw him walking, and I was like, my whole goal for the US Open was just to, you know, retain as much information from some of the best golfers in the world. So I went up to Tiger, Jordan Spieth, talked to Jason Day for a little bit, and then Bryson DeChambeau. And I went up to them, asked them for advice, said, hey man, it's my first PGA Tour event, first major, what's some advice you can give to someone like me? And and Tiger was just like, you know, Bryson said something about trying to be as consistent as possible, just find a way to create your game and, you know, find something and make it the best part of your game. Like, just be really good at driving the ball, or be a really good iron player. Jordan Spieth gave me some advice about the golf course, stay below the hole. And then Tiger just told me to stay patient, you know, and, you know, that people try to press on the golf course and, you know, make a couple bogeys to get rattled and trying to push. And you know, you can't do that. You really got to stay patient. And I was really nervous talking to him. So that was an awesome experience.
Yeah.
So when you arrived for your first round in the US Open, what was going through your mind? I'm sure you were nervous, as it was like your first US Open.
Well, yeah, I was for sure nervous, but the great thing was, well, I don't know if this was a great thing, but there were no fans. So if I hit a bad shot, you know, no one really cared that much. But yeah, I mean, that's an experience like no other. I was definitely nervous. I actually hit a pretty good shot in the first hole. So, you know, that the first shot nerves went away quickly. And, you know, I played with house money basically, because, you know, I had nothing to lose out there. I was just there for the experience. So I wasn't extremely nervous, but, you know, everyone always wants to play well. So.
And you mentioned that conversation with Tiger about like the importance of staying patient and not like pressing forward. Like, can you like give our listeners, and also myself, who knows nothing, next to nothing about golf, like a little bit of like insight into like that strategy that like you have, and then also other golfers have?
Yeah. So I guess last week I did a bad, you know, I didn't play very well, and, you know, I made a few bogeys, and, you know, say there's like a back left pin, and that's something you shouldn't go for. You should just hit in the middle of the green, try to two putt, but you just made two bogeys and you want to make a birdie, and, you know, you get too aggressive and you hit it over the green and you make a bogey. And it's just so unnecessary, because, you know, I understand you're frustrated, but just be patient, because your opportunities will keep coming. And what I should have done is just hit it in the middle of green, two putt, but since I got impatient, wanting that birdie so badly, I hit it over the green to make another bogey. So especially like a tough golf course like Wingfoot, staying patient is so important because there's so many bogey holes out there. And mm-hmm. you just want to play smart, play safe, and just, you know, when the opportunities come, take advantage of it.
Yeah. And so like last week, you're talking like, what were you feeling in the moment? Like, I know like in hindsight, you're like, I shouldn't have forced that. But like, what was your mindset in the moment there?
I was like, I can do it. I can get it close. That's definitely my mindset. And it didn't work out well, but you know, you learn from it.
But like, as Wayne Gretzky says, right, you miss 100% of the shots you don't take.
There's also that kind of mindset too, but I like to, I think in golf, you might want to be a little more, you know, patient and safe.
Absolutely.
That's why your golf game isn't blossoming.
Yeah, that's why my golf game, because I'm always trying to go for it. Like the, I don't know.
Hey, I respect those players. there are guys like that, but that's just not my game.
Yeah. So we were following that week during the U.S. Open on the, I think it was the U.S. Open virtual something app where we could like point our phone at something and then show the course.
I remember that.
Yeah, it was just great to watch. And it was amazing to see you like up there after all the years of hearing about you and your dad just telling about where you're playing now next and all that. But I'm just wondering, was there a moment in the U.S. Open, because you played so good, able to make the cut, that you felt that this is where you belong and like this is your future?
Yeah, I think the cool thing about the U.S. Open is there's people that are keeping all your stats and show where you rank against the best players in the world. So I finished around like 15th in fairways and then 21st in greens in regulation or something like that. I'm not sure exactly, but it showed that I can compete against them, that my ball striking is just there. It's right up there with them. I did finish, I think, 52nd out of 52 people in putting. So that shows where I need to improve on my golf game. So I think that if I just work a little harder on those areas, why can't I be competing against them on a week-to-week basis? So I think just being able to see that I made the cut and competed against them and, you know, just the statistics show that I was kind of up there with them, you know, kind of proves to me that I can do this every week.
And so like kind of going back to like the practice aspect of things, it's like 6 to 7 hours like per day, I'm sure like takes a toll on your body. So like, have you added, like, have you, as you rose in the ranks, like, have you added like any like stretching or like nutritional aspects to like your training and stuff?
Yeah. So, I stretch every day before practice, you know, it's just something you have to do. And then, at Florida State, we have a great, recovery program. Like we can go into the stadium where, you know, we have sports medicine and they have these like Normatec boots where you put your legs in and it just, have you heard of those?
Yes.
Normatec boots?
Yes.
Yes. And we have those, so we can go in there every day. Then we also have hot and cold tubs in the stadium, so we do that for recovery. So we try to take care of our bodies, because I think, you know, we work out 5 days a week and you're beating golf balls and your body takes a toll. So you got to learn how to, you know, recover.
You're treated world class. Are those boots the real deal over there?
Oh yeah. They're amazing. So we walked 36 holes in our tournament last week and my legs were shot, and then just threw those on and I felt amazing the next day.
Wow. So like, yeah, how many miles do you think you walk over those 36 holes?
I gotta be honest, I'd say close to like 10, in between 10 and 15. I'm not sure, honestly.
And then you still have to hit.
Do you guys know what a whoop is?
Mm-mm.
It's like it's this thing where it's on your like wrist. I put it on my ankle and it tracks like.
Oh, I've heard of that actually.
It tracks your sleep and your strain and your recovery and everything. And it can track how many calories you burn. I think I burned like 4,000 calories that day.
That is crazy.
Yeah. So, I mean, It's surprising how much you burn when you you play, how many calories you burn playing golf. I didn't realize that.
And so there's no golf carts allowed, right?
Some tournaments we do.
That's cool. Wow. Noah, I'm learning more with each question. This is fascinating.
Maybe it'll get you into the golf game a little more.
Definitely.
I'm just wondering, this is sort of from like a fan's perspective. Did you have a favorite playing partner at the US Open, or like maybe someone who is forthcoming in advice and or just like nice to you, like not like rookie like throwing you around, like someone who's just nice and
so I not during the tournament, but in the practice round, I played with Joaquin Niemann, and I played a good amount of golf with him back when I was a junior golfer, and you know, we're actually the same age, and I think he's won twice on the PGA Tour, so he's really, really good. And you know, he kind of just, I asked him to play in the practice round, and he said yeah, of course. And you know, we text every once in a while, and you know, he kind of told me that, like, he should come to Jupiter, and I guess that's now where I'm gonna live. And I thought he was it was really cool that he, you know, he would help me out with all those things. I also played with Troy Merritt, and his caddy was Wayne, and they're just hilarious. Wayne was, he was a funny guy, and we were talking about fantasy football and stuff. So that was a good time.
That's awesome. So during, I kind of want to backtrack here. Noah, do you have any other questions about the US Open?
Yeah, I'll just ask this one. The second place finisher in the US Open, Matthew Wolf, who's around the same age as you. You spoke about him and competing with him in college. And like when discussing the week, you said, my good is just as good as anyone else's, but I feel they're just way more consistently good. Like, how does a guy like Wolf serve as an inspiration to you? And seeing his success, does this give you any newfound confidence that you can make it at this level too?
Oh, definitely, for sure. So seeing Matt out there, so good for him, and you know, I'm happy for him. But I guess that just kind of proves that if I was competing against him in college, and he's beating PGA Tour players, why can't I do the same? And it gives me hope. You know, same with Colin Morikawa and Victor Hovland. I played against all those guys, Joaquin, and you know, I'm not far behind them. I feel like I just need to push myself in a little more, you know, practice, put a little more extra work in, and I can be right there with them.
So I know we're kind of going all over the place here, but I wanted to like backtrack to your college golf. And well, of course you're still in college, but why did you decide to choose to play at Florida State? And like, what were the other offers that you were considering?
So when I was in high school, I visited 8 schools. I went to Oklahoma State, Clemson, North Carolina, Texas, and then 4 Florida schools, Florida State, Florida, UCF, and USF. And I actually really wanted to go to Texas, but then, you know, they took a couple other guys over me. So then that was out of it. And then I wanted to go to, then it was between Florida State, UCF, and USF. And it's just, if you just look at their football programs, their athletic department and everything, Florida State just, they just have a lot more money, a lot more success in the athletic department. And, you know, when your football team is that, I mean, not right now at the moment, we're not doing very well, but you know, when you have success in the athletic department, you know, that just proves that good athletes go here. And not only that, Brooks Koepka, Daniel Berger, Jonas Blix, they all went to Florida State. They're all decent in high school, but under Coach Trey Jones, they got even better. So there are just so many, our facilities are better. So there are just so many things pointing at Florida State. And I think it's probably the best decision I made in my life so far.
Well, yeah, you mentioned your coach. How much has he made an impact on your game? Like on a scale of 1 to 10, you'd say.
On a scale of 1 to 10. I'd say, you know, like a 7 or 8. He's definitely, you know, I speak to him every day. I see him every day. He's at practice. So, this is a reminder. Hold on. Alexa, stop. just he, you know, one thing I didn't know when I got to school was that, you know, I need to work on my wedges. You know, they know my game very well, so they can help me, you know, get it from that next level to and get my game to a point where I can compete on the PGA Tour.
So as a freshman, you came in and made an immediate impact. What was it like to come in and play your best golf, like, immediately?
It felt good. I was definitely a little intimidated by the older guys. We had a kid that played in the Masters that year, Harry Ellis. He was my teammate. He was a senior. And, you know, we had some pretty big expectations on the team. And I think that it felt good to, you know, hear that it felt good to know that your teammates thought heard of you and, you know, you're supposed to be good and actually perform. You know, a lot of guys get a little overwhelmed and, you know, it's pretty hard to perform under that kind of pressure, but, you know, it definitely felt good to, you know, come hot right out of the gates.
Yeah. And then jumping to your junior year. So that was the season in the spring where it was canceled due to COVID. And right up to that, you were averaging a 69.4. So how'd you keep your mind in, like, the right place, knowing that you were playing so well and then your momentum kind of comes to a sudden halt?
You know, it is what it is. COVID, you know, it didn't just take a toll on me. It took a toll on everyone. So, you know, you just got to, you know, look at it and just say, whatever, you just got to do what you got to do. And I think momentum's pretty big in golf as well. You know, I was playing really well and it kind of sucks because we were going to one of my favorite tournaments at Floridian and Jupiter. And, you know, I finished second there the last 2 years. And I thought I was going to have a good week, but, you know, COVID came up and, you know, you can't do anything about it. So you just kind of just look past it and move on. Right.
Yeah. I just have a quick question. Mm-hmm. Is Jupiter where Michael Jordan's golf course is located?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it is. Yeah.
So I was listening to a podcast earlier and the guy, David Alexander, who's a prominent trainer in Florida in the Miami area, like, he's trained like Dwayne Wade and LeBron James. Anyway, Dwayne Wade took David Alexander up to Jupiter where Michael Jordan's course is located. And he was talking about how at the gate where you drive up, there's someone at the gate and they ask you, what kind of ball do you play? And so you tell them, and then by the time you get to your golf cart, a bag of balls is ready for you in your golf cart and you could just use the range to practice.
That's insane. Yeah, there's like everyone's in Jupiter. Like, Brooks is there, Tiger's there, Dustin Johnson, Rory, Ricky, everyone's in Jupiter. There's a lot of good golf courses in that area.
And the food and drinks are delivered by drones. And Michael Jordan's golf course.
I heard about that. I heard they kind of got in trouble for that, though.
I also heard that the golf carts, you could go wherever you want with the golf carts. Like, they don't have, like, a certain, like, track that you could only drive
on. Oh, really?
Yeah, so.
Yeah. I bet it's pretty sick. It's very exclusive, so.
Well, I'm sure you'll be there one day.
Hopefully. That's the goal. If I'm there, that's when I know I made it.
Yeah. Anyway, no.
I'm just wondering, have you ever gone through like a slump in your golf career at all, or a period of a couple weeks maybe where you weren't shooting so well?
I definitely have. Oh yeah, for sure. So after my freshman year, I went to Scotland and I played terrible. I missed both cuts that I went to, and yeah, I think I shot in the 80s one day, probably my worst tournament in so long, and I wasn't playing very well. I came back to America, and I don't know if you know, like, golf in Scotland's very different from.
Were you in the fescue a lot? At the fescue? Is that?
I did hit in the fescue quite a bit, yeah. But it was so windy. The ground was so firm, and it's such different golf. And
that's when New Jersey could help you out.
You would think, but it's so different, man. It's unreal how, yeah. I don't think people know that because it's called Lynx golf, where the ground's firmer. It blows like 40 miles an hour on a windy day. You don't really get that in America unless there's like a tropical storm, you know? So I struggled pretty badly that summer, and I think it was a good learning experience because I learned a lot from it. Like, I've never experienced that type of golf, and it made my, you know, golfing arsenal a lot bigger. Like, I learned how to hit different shots, so I think it was really important to go out there. I always tell my teammates, try and do it, but never listen. But I think it was a good learning experience, and I definitely struggled, but I think I learned a lot of valuable lessons and got better from it.
And so the Royal Lynx at Liverpool, right? Is that the name of the tournament?
It was the Walker Cup at Royal Liverpool.
Oh, Royal Liverpool. So that was near summer of 2019. And mm-hmm. you had high finishes in the Western Amateur, US Amateur, and then the Walker Cup win. And you won all three of those matches at the Walker Cup. And then mm-hmm. you actually had one with the putt on the final hole, which like clinched it. That's like Michael Jordan hitting a buzzer beater. So like, what was that? What was that like?
So it wasn't the clinch, but it was the second day of singles, and we were down bad. And I was one of the last matches out there, and I was one down with three to play, mm-hmm. or one down with two to play. And I won 17, and then made like a 9-footer on 18 in front of all my teammates.
Wow.
And, you know, I threw a fist pump in there. I got super excited. And, you know, we kind of ended the day on that note, and you can just tell like the momentum switched. And, you know, even though we were down a few points, mm-hmm. in reality, it felt like we were up. So, you know, I felt like I definitely had like a little momentum shift, and, you know, our team was a little lifted, and I think that kind of pushed us in the right direction to win the tournament.
That's the awesome. Cup. Oh, Noah?
Sorry, my internet right now is not where it's at. Do you have a favorite course that you've played on so far? You've played at a lot of courses, so I was wondering.
Yeah, there's so many. sorry. Have you guys heard of Pine Valley?
No, where's that?
It's in New Jersey, actually. It's a number one ranked golf course in the world.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's like an hour from us. But I was able to play that golf course. So a member invited me out there to play with two of my buddies. And that course is special. Like, it's the number one golf course in the world. So you can't – it's just – that already speaks for itself.
How does it rank next to Shaq?
Shaq and Matt? It's a lot better. I mean, Shaq's nice, but if you ask any golfer and you say the words Pine Valley, they'll be jealous that you played it. That's just how good it is.
So I guess what makes Pine Valley like better than the rest?
It's an immaculate shape. Layout's really good. And it's just really, golfers like to use the word pure, mm-hmm. and it's just unbelievably pure. So yeah, it's just really good.
Noah, I would be banned from there before I'd even walk in. I played my first round of golf this past summer with Noah at Scotch Hills, and
that's the only place they'll let us. The 9-hole course on the side of a road. That's the only place they'll let us in with Matt.
I got yelled at like after like the first hole because I didn't realize like after you hit the ball and like the divot, I didn't realize you were supposed to put back the divot. So I just left it there, and they tracked me, and they came up to the second hole, and they started yelling at me.
Yeah, you gotta fill in your divots, man.
So I'm like the bad golfer on the course, but it's
as long as you're enjoying it.
Exactly.
We're getting there to the point where you're enjoying it.
Hopefully this spring. Yes. So I just have one question about like. So you're playing, of course, on a team for Florida State, but like, is it still like how is it different between like your solo versus like a team? Like, do you consider golf currently a team sport, or is it more like yourself?
I the way I see it is it's still an individual sport. And if I do my job, the team does well. So as long as I do what I need to do, we'll win as a, you know, we'll do well as a team. It's a lot of fun being on a team because during practice, you guys compete against each other, learn from each other. But at the end of the day, you know, you gotta do everything on your own and say, at the end of the day, it's an individual sport. So if I do well, we do well as a team. And that's just how it works.
Do you think that, I don't know, maybe college golf could be done like individually, like not so much team based? Could it be done like you represent Florida State in a tournament and not be done through points? Could that be feasible or no? Is it just better as a team, as like
I think it's really good as a team right now. I think the format they have is I don't think they'll ever change it, and I think it's the best they can do. Yeah, but I think college golf is something everyone should do that's trying to play professionally, because I've learned so much since I've been here.
All right. I just want to know, because I just want to know, have you ever hit a hole in one? Because that's like the when you know maybe you got lucky, but that's when you know you're good enough. Like,
so I've made two in the last, year and a half, and those are the only two I've made in my whole life.
Wow!
So I've been playing golf for 15 years, and my first 13 years of golf, I've never made a hole in one. And I've hit a lot of golf shots, a lot of par three shots. And then I had one at the Western Am practice round about a year and a half ago. And then the second hole in one I had, it was actually a pretty cool story. It was the very first day our golf course opened in Tallahassee. At first day, we just built a brand new golf course earlier last year. The very first day it opened up, I made a hole in one on the fourth hole. That's so amazing. That was pretty. First hole in one on that golf course, so that was a pretty cool story.
How did you react to the
I had the same question.
I actually flew it right in. It didn't bounce. I dunked it right in the hole. So, and I was playing with three of my teammates, and we were like, "Oh my god, it went in!" Yeah, we're amazing. Going crazy.
Yeah, I go pretty insane if I manage to like chip it in from on the fringe of the green. So
I just get excited if I get it in on mini golf. Hole in one on mini golf?
Yeah, that hey. Exactly. Hole in ones are always nice.
How close do you think you are to like your 10,000 hours? Like, they're always talking about 10,000 hours is when you master something.
I've heard that too before. Dude, I have no, like, is there some way you can simplify that? Like, how many, you know, how many hours a day would you do for a certain amount of days straight? Like,
well, yeah, like you're playing golf like 7 hours per day. You multiply that by, I don't know, like 350.
I can't even do the math. Like, if you could do the math, I could probably tell you, but I feel like I did.
2,100 hours if you do 350 days, 6 hours per day. That's 2,100 hours per year.
Yeah, I think I've surpassed 10,000 hours.
Wow.
I think I have.
That's amazing.
What it takes.
Before we wrap up here, I just want to do a little bit of a speed round here.
Okay.
All right. So favorite club you use?
8-iron.
I saw that mentioned.
What type of brand? Isn't there like a Tiger Woods like 8-iron?
I use the TaylorMade clubs.
Okay, cool. All right, Noah, your turn.
Let's see. I mean, this is on the fly speed round. So, favorite type of hole, par 3, 4, or 5.
Par 5s. scoring holes, man. Yeah, I love par fives.
What ball do you use?
I use a Titleist Pro V1X.
I've tried. So I had a I hired someone to teach me how to play golf this past summer. Do you know who John Turnbull is?
That name sounds so familiar. Wait, hold on. Did he play coach the golf team at Westfield?
Maybe at one point. He was the wrestling coach for Scotch Plains, but like he taught a bunch of golfers.
Okay, gotcha. that name sounds really familiar. I think I know who that is.
Yeah, he let me hit one Pro V1X, the Titleist.
Yeah, there's actually a big difference between the golf balls like on the golf range versus the one, the Pro V1X is like $4 golf balls.
Incredible.
Something like that. Yeah.
No.
All right. Let's see. Favorite non-golf activity.
Probably I like to play video games. I'm a big Call of Duty guy.
Call of Duty.
Nice. So, shoot. All right.
I think our speed round is
fine. Yeah, I think our speed round. What's like your go-to like shirt on like a big tournament day?
We have a Sunday kind of like the Tiger outfit. We do the same for final round of our college tournaments. We wear a garnet shirt and like khaki pants, and every single picture if we ever win a tournament, it's that same outfit. So I guess amazing. Hopefully maybe in the future I'll stick with that, who knows.
Are you like very superstitious about like how like you go about like your routine leading up to hitting the course?
A little bit. I got like I can't have more than 4 tees in my pocket. I know that's a little weird. I've always thought that if I played bad in the practice round, I'll play good in the tournament.
Thought about that too. Like I play soccer, and like I remember having some like bad practices leading up to like games, but then bad practice, good game.
Yeah, dude, it's insane. So I don't know. Golfers might be some of the most superstitious people you'll ever meet. So
do you eat like a special breakfast every time or no?
No. I'm not as bad as most golfers. I'm pretty laid back.
Cool.
I'm just interested since I'm a huge fan of Duncan Robinson on the Miami Heat.
Okay.
He's like a sharpshooter, so there might be some things like with like shooting like a basketball like and golf with like the hours of spent trying to perfect your craft. I'm wondering like after a bad game he'll say like he's not gonna go back in the gym and do an extra 100 like free throws or an extra 100 three-pointers because he knows like he put in the work before and the ball just didn't fall, and he's gonna continue with his habits. Are you similar like that? Are you gonna go after a bad round go practice for an extra hour if you have it, or are you gonna keep doing the same thing, stick to your habits?
I watch a lot of basketball. I'm a big NBA fan, so I know who exactly Duncan Robinson is, but that's actually really cool that he says that, because I kind of feel the same way. I've already, we did the math. I've put in more than 10,000 hours practicing golf. So just because I had one bad day doesn't mean that reflects my whole entire game. So it could have just been one bad day, and, I go the next day and then I could hit it amazing. There have been times where I've shot 75 and then the next day I could shoot 65, And I bet you Duncan Robinson could, go like 1-for-7 from the 3-point line. The next game he can make 7-of-8. So, mm-hmm.
Yeah, he
never know
that all the time.
Are you a Heat fan?
No, I'm a massive Knicks fan.
Wow.
Knicks.
Yeah. You guys are from New Jersey. What's going on?
The New Jersey Nets.
I know. I was never a Nets guy. I always grew up watching the Knicks.
And then when the Sonics moved to Oklahoma City, some people had to root for them. They needed a fan base, so I joined the fan base.
You're a Nets guy?
No, I'm a Thunder guy.
Oh, you're a Thunder guy.
I'm the Nets guy.
Yeah, he's a Nets. But I did go to New Jersey Nets games before the Nets became cool.
Hey, they were still good, like when they had like Jason Kidd, and that was a long time ago.
We talked about this at the end of the last podcast. Gerald Green, the Green Machine. They used to play the same thing every time.
Yeah, I was always a massive Knicks fan, and then we just kind of stink right now, but we're trending in the right direction.
Yeah. So, Noah, you have anything else before we wrap up here?
No, I just want to – I never got the chance. I want to thank you for the hat. I got to thank your dad, but this meant a lot. I was like, why me? That was so nice of you. I was grateful.
No worries. A big thing for me is I kind of want to grow the game of golf because I think it's such an awesome sport to play. Like, even if you don't play professionally, you can create so many relationships through golf. And it's kind of incredible from like even a business standpoint. Like,
well, that's one of the reasons why I started picking up the game.
Like, no, I'm serious.
Be useful in the future.
You really should, because it could help you big time. Because you know a lot of business decisions are actually made on the golf course. You'd be shocked. So, I think golf's an awesome game, and you know I'd love to see younger kids pick up golf and play it. And just I think it's just an awesome sport to play.
Well, thanks again, John, for spending some time with us.
Yeah, no problem, guys. Thanks for having me on the podcast.
Yeah. All right, we'll see you soon.
All right, sounds good. See you guys.
All right.